Shalom, welcome to Israeli Salad. Today on our program, we are starting our program from the distribution center of the Pitchon Lev organization. So don't go anywhere. We'll be right back trying to understand how sometimes the most important thing is to just give. Shalom, as I said, I am here in the Pitchon Lev Distribution Center. Pitchon Lev is one of the many organizations in Israel who help people in need. I spoke to Nisim Tzioni, who is the founder and the manager of the Pitchon Lev organization. Nisim Tzioni was working as a radio broadcaster when he met a woman who told him that she and her two sons have not eaten for 2 days. This meeting brought Nisim to leave his successful business and found the Pitchon Lev organization.
We distribute thousands of food packages for families in need from two locations.
Each Thursday, many people arrive at the Pitchon Lev distribution center, people who don't have the means to buy basic groceries for their home. The special packages can be purchased at the distribution center for less than $2 per package.
Here we have flour, rice, sugar, fish, canned food, and a variety of salads and baby food.
As the Rosh Hashanah holiday approaches, Pitchon Lev is working harder. On one hand, many families are requesting help to provide food for the festival meals. And on the other hand, because of the festival of Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, hearts are more open, and there is a large amount of people who want to help and donate. Banks and community centers throughout the country have become Pitchon Lev collection centers. People can bring food and other articles to the Pitchon Lev center near their home, and all the food and donations are then sorted at the central Pitchon Lev distribution center.
One mother came over to me and handed me her baby and ran away. She said that she doesn't have the means to support her child. Eventually we reached her, and we made sure she received help and support.
The organization works in cooperation with the Israeli army. Nisim has asked commanders how units have time for these activities that are absolutely not security related.
They told me, Nisim, it's very important for us to educate our soldiers to give to society. It's no less important than patrols and other security operations.
The Pitchon Lev organization realizes that it is not enough to give people in need material help, but it's important to help teach these people how to cope with the real world. To achieve this goal, the organization opened the Pitchon Lev College. The college tries to give them knowledge and capabilities to enter the workforce. For example, there are courses on how to write a resume, how to work under authority, how to save money, and how to improve self-esteem. Nisim told me that the public cooperation is amazing. People just want to give more and more.
We must understand what's happening in Israel. Israel is going through one of the toughest times ever. There are more than 1 million people who are hungry. I ask whoever wants to make our dream into a reality to contact Pitchon Lev to help the people in need in Israel.
So that's all for now from the distribution center of the Pitchon Lev organization. Don't go anywhere. We will be right back in just a moment. Stay tuned.
What does the Western Wall mean to you?
The Kotel is Israel to me, and it makes me feel amazing, and it's emotional, and just it's great.
Okay, welcome back. We now continue with Mark's tour through the world of Israeli Jewish art. Today, Mark Kaplan meets Yael Aviona from Jerusalem, who uses Kabbalistic themes in her artwork.
Shalom. We are once again at the home and studios of artists Dov Letterberg and Yael Aviona. Last time, we took a look at some of the works of Dov Letterberg. And today, we're going to take a look at some of the works of his wife, Yael. So let's take a look.
He Here you see a hieroglyphic painting, kinetic, of the angel Michael, part of a series of the four major angels. Michael is described as the water element, and that's why you see as if you're throwing a pebble into the water. You see the lion.
The ripple and effect.
The ripple effect. Yeah, you see, if I'm turning it fast, you actually don't see any detail. You just see really throwing the pebble and the ripples are coming to you, going into inside water. And when it slowed down a bit, you suddenly see the other element, the right hand. He's one of the rotating swords, so the rotating sword inside, and the right hand of God. In my right is Michael, in my left. And the same effect is in the other angels. Another painting that is also based on giving ideas through visual is Jerusalem at the time of the Messiah. It's a square city. In the middle is the stone that the whole world is based on it, like a core of an atom. And all the other nations, they will be separate. They'll come to the same temple, but on different area. That stone, if you turn it very fast, everything diminishes, only the stone as a core remain. And here is the new attitude to mine, through light to show the beauty of praying and of praying for Jerusalem at the time of the Messiah. So this is a young girl, she's praying and she's concentrating when the light is coming out, that's the praying, like wing. Being born in Jerusalem and being a daughter of archaeologist who did the model of Jerusalem at the second temple, I always laugh and say, I will be the expert on the third temple, hopefully. This is a vision I had for many years, as if you are standing on the Mount of Olives and the river of life already occur, and the city appears reflecting in the river when the tree of life is coming through, actually the Mizbeach, and you have the DNA coming down, life is coming out, the tree of life. This is actually Shara Chamin, where hopefully all the resurrection will come, and I'm preparing the gate. Even the foundation of Jerusalem at the time of the Messiah will be made of precious stones. And this is again the river, the floating city, floating on the rivers of life. What frightened me, that letters appear in the text, in the canvas that I did not paint.
But these letters were not intentional.
No,
you didn't paint those.
I did not paint it. You see, did not paint it. It comes here, it's like a line. I don't know what is written. It's emulsion that comes from two different materials, oil and acrylic. When they work together, create some kind of a effect. Here is the beginning, is the end. The painting like that, it's like the egg divided the three shrine and then the four upper Jerusalem at the time of the Messiah, upper Garden of Eden, and you'll have like letters inside. I don't know if you can see, but you can, okay, and the bird. But these are not even symbols. These are just expression of form to make people feel that things are happening, that things will come, and that's my goal.
Wow, that's some heavy stuff. Since the first day of Elul, members of the Sephardi community have been waking up each morning to say the Slichot, prayers that involve asking forgiveness from God. Starting from the end of the Shabbat, before Rosh Hashanah, the Ashkenazi community begins this tradition. Rabbi Samson joins us from his office in Jerusalem. Rabbi Samson, what's the meaning of these prayers, and how can someone connect with prayers that are written in such an old fashion?
Well, Shalom Yoni. Shalom to all of our listeners and watchers around the world. Yoni, when you ask me about the Slichot and that they were written many years ago, it could be that some of them are a little hard to understand for the masses. But the basic concept of Slichot is a very simple concept, and it is the crux and the essence of tshuva. Tshuva means when a person repents. He wants to fix his ways. Now, what do you need in order to fix your ways? You have to, first of all, recognize the fact that you have done the wrong thing, and that is stating, God, I have done the wrong thing. It's very different than Christian confession. You don't go to a priest, you go to your own heart and soul, and you face God and say, God, I have done the wrong thing. That's stage number one. Stage number two is regretting that you have ever done it. And stage number three is accepting upon yourself that you will never do it again. So that these are the three basic forms of tshuva: past, present, and future. Regretting what you have done in the past, stating in the present, I regret it and I will never do it again in the future. This is the crux of the prayers, and we wake up in the middle of the night because, first of all, anybody who's ever done this knows that it has a really tremendous emotional effect on a person when, instead of sleeping at night, he wakes up, faces God, and does true repentance. And this is the way we face God on the new year with the Rosh Hashanah prayers after we have done complete repentance. I want to hope and wish at this point to ourselves and all of our listeners that we have a successful tshuva process and a happy and a very sweet new year.
Thank you very much, Rabbi Samson, and a good year to you too. When we come back, we will meet Lenny Solomon from the band Shlock. Lenny made Aliyah, immigrated to Israel a few years ago. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
So, why did you come to Israel?
We came for a family vacation to spend time in Israel, visiting sites, enjoying being in the country, being with the people.
Shalom, welcome back to our program. We are now joined by Lenny Solomon from Shlock. So before we start talking, a few tunes, please, Lenny.
You got it. Soup and challah, candlesticks, kiddushin is delicious. Every Shabbat meal we eat is really quite nutritious. Can I have some chicken served on Ima special dishes? Soup and challah, candlesticks, kiddushin is delicious. When I was a little boy, I felt very glad. I'd look forward to Shabbat meals, because every one I had would be a great experience and put me in the know. Listen to the singing and you think you're at a show. Hey! Soup and challah, candlesticks, kiddushin is delicious. Every Shabbat meal we eat is really quite nutritious. Can I have some chicken served on Ima special dishes? Soup and challah, candlesticks, kiddushin is delicious.
We're going to hear some more tunes after, but let's first schmooze. We'll talk a bit.
All right.
First of all, tell us a bit about yourself.
Well, born in Queens and made Aliyah with my wife and family in 1996. We've been here 7 years now. This is the 8th year of Aliyah. Love it here in Beit Shemesh, the place to be for all of you watching. And I'm the head of Shlock, which is a Jewish rock and roll band, spreads Jewish pride, identity, and awareness throughout the world to promote Jewish continuity and Jewish education through music. My career was God-planned. I just put out an album in 1986 called Shlock, Learning is Good, and in it we took songs, popular songs that everybody knew. We changed the words to give it Jewish messages.
When I was in high school, I also took songs and I made my own words, and it was fun, but you do that for a living.
Yeah, a lot of people say that's the biggest. Everybody comes up to me and says, "You know, I used to do that when I was in high school, or I was in elementary school, or I was in college." And then I get emails all the time with people sending me songs that they've written over the years. And the funny thing is that this became a living. I mean, it was just totally not planned. I mean, the first album, Learning is Good, was, you know, I don't want to be disrespectful to the career, but it was a joke. I never planned on being a full-time Jewish rocker, as it were, and now there's 23 Shlock albums.
So what's the secret?
Well, I guess the secret is two things. One is Hashem, God has to be behind you. If God is not behind you, you're not going to do it. He has to approve of what you're doing somehow. He has to sanction your work. That's one thing. And the other thing is that you have to keep working very hard. As much as you have God's blessing, you got to work and work and work. And I've traveled and played over 200 cities in my career, South Africa, Australia, Canada, most of America. We go to places where there are 50 Jews come to a show. And non-Jews too sometimes come. You know, the key really is that you give good energy, you make people feel good about Judaism and good about the Torah, you make them want to learn more. And that's the secret to Shlock.
Now, where'd you get that name, Shlock?
So it was very interesting. Shlock, when I grew up, always meant second hand or used. So when you had a used sofa, you called it a shlocky sofa. So I took rock. The rock, the music became second hand. I took the same songs, I redid the songs, and, you know, and we put in our, my words. So it was new words, second hand music, hence shlock rock.
How's the feedback?
Music goes where words do not. And many people have told me that, and it's true. And through the albums and through the concerts, I've gotten emails from people that have actually embraced Judaism, come closer to Judaism, become more observant, become more spiritual through listening to the songs. But I didn't put out these albums and say, okay, now we're going to go and we're going to make people religious. Or now we're going to go and we are going to teach people Torah through music. That wasn't the plan in the beginning. It became the plan as we moved, as we grew. And now every song that I write has got a purpose, and that purpose is education. And that purpose is making people feel good about Judaism through music.
Has the Aliyah influenced your music?
Yeah, it has. As a matter of fact, the first year that I made Aliyah, I wrote 27 songs, and I put out 3 albums.
So tell us about your latest disc.
Well, the latest disc is what I played, you know, when we started, Soup and Challah, which is called, the album's called Shlock Rock, Almost on Broadway, and it's all Broadway-type songs with the words changed.
Okay, so we're going to end with...
You want to hear another song?
We're going to end with the Aliyah song.
That's right, because it's appropriate that an American living in Israel should play his first... So this was the first song that I wrote after making Aliyah. So everybody knows there's an adjustment period, like a 6-month adjustment period. Sometimes 3 months, sometimes you don't have to adjust. But for me, it was 6 months. And January 9th, my birthday, I looked out onto the mountains of Beit Shemesh, and I wrote this. Okay, it's called Aliyah Dream.
So we're going to end with this song. And to all our viewers, join us again next week for another edition of Israeli Salad. So Lenny, go ahead.
Thank you very much. Here we go. Well, the streets are going up in Beit Shemesh, and the roads are being paved with my dreams. The lights of the city are still not far away. Well, the sun is beating down in the valley. I see the mountains smile as I drive by. Got my head in the clouds, but my feet planted on the ground. This is my Aliyah dream, and it's coming true. I know I found my place here as a Jew. This is my Aliyah dream for my family. Yeah, come on in, be part of history. Every day's another adventure. I'm getting closer all the time to fitting in. I'll take the challenge, I know that I'm gonna win. Everybody does their share of complaining, but it's time for the work to begin. Each one has a purpose, just gotta figure out what it is. This is my Aliyah dream, and it's coming true. I know I found my place here as a Jew. This is my Aliyah dream for my family. Yeah, come on in, be part of history.
Thank you very much.
All right.